Good morning. I'm Dr. John Downing. I'm in Kentucky in the United States. Very happy to have you join us this morning. I have been going on missions with Orbis since 1989, and I think it's a wonderful organization, and that Cybersight really is making their programs available to lots of people everywhere. I'm going to talk this morning a little bit about how Phaco works, Phacodynamics, the principles. There have been tremendous increases in cataract surgery improvements in the past 50 years. I started in ophthalmology 51 years ago. We were doing intracaps with aphakic glasses, and they were not very effective. You couldn't do people with cataracts in one eye because of the difference in image size. But things have really changed a lot since, literally more than in the previous 3,000 years. A lot of this has to do with the fact that we can use a much smaller incision size. We've gone from having cataract glasses to correct to first contact lenses and then intraocular lenses, which are just an unbelievable step forward. People in particularly developing countries who had cataract surgery before we had intraocular lenses and had to wear aphakic glasses, frequently they would be lost or damaged in the first year or so after surgery. And after that, they generally had uncorrected vision, which was 2200 or less. And cataract surgery has now become a very precise refractive procedure. Now, how does this work? First is intraocular lenses, moving the optical correction from in front of the eyes to inside in the natural spot where the natural lens was. And the invention of phacoemulsification, which allowed us to use very small incisions with very little induced astigmatism and quick healing. We have developed precise measurements. 50 years ago, we had no way to measure what power lenses that we had to use. We had to just use, when we first had intraocular lenses, we just used a standard power, which sometimes were okay and frequently were not. And now, with phacoemulsification, intraocular lenses and precise measurements, we can correct myopia, hyperopia, and astigmatism, usually with good accuracy. Somewhere between 75 and 85%, we can get within plus or minus a half diopter of where we want to focus them. Phaco was developed by Dr. Charles Kelman about 1967. It's simply a small incision extra cap. The cataract surgery we were doing at the time required a 180 degree incision. We were closing the incision with usually 5-8 over silk sutures. They were slow to heal. The healing changed for years, so you had to keep changing the prescriptions in their glasses. Phaco is a minimally invasive closed system where you can get a stable anterior chamber and posterior capsule. But as I say, it was developed before its time. We didn't have intraocular lenses. Ridley implanted the first lens in 1951, had mixed success, reported it about 3 or 4 years later, and was just reviled. There had never been an artificial implant that could be placed in the body that worked. And intraocular lenses were not accepted for more than 20 years. And even then, they were rigid lenses, still required a large incision, so there was very little advantage to doing phaco. What did finally make it successful was that the small incision induced minimal surgical astigmatism change. It became stable quickly. And then intraocular lenses, when particularly we had foldable lenses in the mid-70s, and then accurate measurements and calculation formulas. That's Dr. Charles Kelman on the right, Henry Mitchell on the left. Henry was his technician for the first several years. When Dr. Kelman wanted a setting changed, he'd tell Henry, and Henry would dial it into the machine. I often took an hour or more of phaco time with that machine. This picture was taken at the 25-year anniversary of its invention. And Dr. Kelman died several years ago, unfortunately. Henry Mitchell is still going strong. He works for Crestpoint. And if you happen to be going to the American Academy of Ophthalmology next week, stop by Crestpoint, and Henry will give you all sorts of stories about the early days of phacoemulsification. Now, phaco has advantages and disadvantages. The big advantage is you get predictable good vision quickly, and most of the world, it's the preferred method of cataract surgery because of the advantages. The disadvantages are it requires expensive equipment, you have problems with maintenance, and you have disposables in most machines where you have ongoing costs with every case. But it has uses even in poor developing countries. Many countries in the world, there's a marked shortage of ophthalmologists, and the ones who are there really do not do a lot of surgery. They're usually in the capital cities of the countries even, so there's very little out in the periphery of the country in the countryside. That is changing in several countries. But it can be used to generate income even in very poor countries. You may have a country where 90% of the people are very poor, but you have 10% in almost every country that are middle class or above and want modern care, and they're willing to pay for it. An example of where this has been used is the Aravan system in southern India. It was started by Dr. Venkataswamy. He was 57 when he started it. He retired from government service, and he had the small goal. He wanted to end needless blindness. And there are at least 45 million people in India who are blind from cataract, with very few people to take care of it at the time. He started in 1976 with an 11-bed hospital. The system has grown. There are now 11 hospitals. They have very high volume, very high quality. Most of the surgeries are done with small incision extra cap, but about one-third of the patients are paying patients. And there are several levels of care up to phacoemulsification with foldable intraocular lenses. Those patients generate enough income that about two-thirds of the patients are done at no charge with small incision extra cap. And it's been a self-supporting system ever since it started. There's a book, An Infinite Vision, which tells the story of Aravan. It is well worth reading. It's fascinating. Well, how does phaco work? Basically, you have an ultrasonic tip which vibrates, breaks up lens material. It's like a miniature jackhammer. It just moves forward and back. It does it very fast. You have to have a cycle rate of 35 to 40,000 cycles per second to overcome inertia. And it only cuts on the forward stroke. Then aspiration has to pull it, the material back to the tip, and you get another forward stroke very rapidly, and it cuts into small pieces or emulsifies. The basics of the machine are really pretty simple. You have fluid inflow. You have a bottle, usually with balanced salt in it. And most machines just use gravity flow so that the bottle height and the port size control the rate of flow into the machine when the valve is open to let fluid in. You have an aspiration pump, which pulls material to the tip in the eye and then pulls it, emulsified material on through the eye into a disposal bag. Vacuum is generated when the tip is occluded. You don't get any vacuum unless you have the tip occluded. But once it's occluded and vacuum builds, then it helps hold the material on the tip so you can cut. The handpiece has an electrical input to cause the vibration. You have an irrigation line which brings fluid in from the bottle. It goes out through the side ports on the plastic sleeve around the metal tip. Then when the pump is running, fluid is aspirated through the end of the tip and taken out through the aspiration line. This is a schematic, basically, of how machines work. You have a bottle of fluid. The tubing goes through a pinch valve. And when the pinch valve is open, fluid is irrigated through the tip, through those side ports, and into the eye. When you have a pump, then, which pulls fluid through the end of the tip and through the pump and into a disposal bag. You set the maximum vacuum you want. There's a gauge to show how much actual vacuum you're getting. You set the maximum phaco power you want. And then there's a gauge which shows how much phaco power you're using at any given moment. A major advance was torsional phaco. It was invented about 2005, and a number of machines now have similar features, where you have side-to-side sweeping motions instead of forward and back like a jackhammer. It goes side-to-side. So it doesn't repel lens material. It shaves it, and it cuts on both directions of movement. And this shows longitudinal and torsional
block aspiration to complete desiccation. With ultra high speed video imaging, we have discovered the truth about phacoemulsification. This marks a new era in PEA, from phaco cutting to true emulsification. We conducted a series of experiments. Two strong lines were focused on the test chamber so that these experiments could be captured by a high-speed digital video camera. With this technology, never-before-seen phenomena can be captured, providing new insights and understandings. And we were able to discover the effectiveness of the torsional tip. To study the action of the torsional phaco tip, we placed human nuclei and chestnuts into the test chamber and emulsified them under ultra-high-speed digital video vision. We were able to observe the movement of the tip, points of cavitation, and the speed of emulsification. Torsional action creates four points of cavitation, represented here by the bubbles, existing both on the inside and outside edges of the tip. This suggests four cuts per vibration, making it the same as a phaco tip operating at 128 kilohertz. The ultra-high-speed images show the torsional movement of the tip, and now the longitudinal movement. The points of cavitation made by the oscillating action on the inside and outside circumference of the tip are clearly visible. From this side view, we can see that traditional phacoemulsification or phaco cutting works like a jackhammer, boring a hole through the nucleus, then slicing off pieces and aspirating these pieces whole. This top view shows how the tip breaks the nucleus into fragments and kicks away these fragments before cutting them down for aspiration. The nucleus is not actually emulsified. With real PEA, using a traditional tip on hyperpulse mode, the tip jabs into the nucleus several times, each time slicing off only part of the nucleus. This is a typical example of how the traditional tip uses a one pulse, one cut motion to reduce the size of the nucleus before aspiration. It also highlights the problem of chattering, which causes inefficient PEA. The torsional tip does not have the jackhammer-like action of the traditional tip. Instead, it has a shaving motion. This cross-section of the tip shows how true emulsification occurs. It is this action, too, that allows for the nucleus to always be in contact with or very close to the tip, making for a more silent, chatter-free PEA. You will see four PEA cases of various grades operated using the torsional phaco emulsifier. The angular shape of the Kelmann tip allows for a wide shaving zone during torsional PEA. The torsional tip is able to penetrate deeply into the nucleus and then keep the nucleus at the tip for emulsification. There is no coin or column cutting motion and therefore no chattering. Without the chattering motion, there is no need for the surgeon to chase the nucleus, making PEA smoother. Note that PEA is fast with the torsional tip. The efficiency of the torsional tip comes from its action. In conclusion, let's compare the effectiveness of the treatment and torsional tips. The cavitation points increase from 1 to a more effective 4 points. From the boring and slicing action of phaco cutting to the shaving action of true emulsification, the secret to true emulsification lies in the movement of the tip. The torsional motion shaves the nucleus before aspiration. The torsional action eliminates the problem of chattering, making PEA fast and effective.
For efficient torsional, you need to use a curved tip because it sweeps back and forth. You get a larger sweep that way than if you're just straight. You control the machine with a foot pedal. And this is a diagram of the foot pedal. With your foot off of it, it's called position 0. You press down and you'll hear a click, which puts you in position 1, which lets fluid flow into the eye. Press down a little further, it's called position 2. You'll hear the pump start running. Press down a little bit more and you'll hear a buzz, which is phaco power coming in. And we normally set the phaco power so it's proportional to how far down into position 3 you go. So 0, you foot off the pedal, nothing happens. There's nothing going in or out of the eye. Foot pedal position 1, you'll hear a click. That opens the inflow valve to the bottle and essentially then lets fluid flow into the eye. Intraocular pressure is going to be equal to bottle height, but there's no flow through the eye at that point, except maybe a little leakage around the tip. You need a snug fit, but not too tight. So you need a precise incision size to get that. Foot pedal position 2, you press down just a little further, you'll hear the pump start running. It adds aspiration, pulls fluid through the eye, into the phaco tip, and out of the eye. The flow rate depends on how fast the pump is running, and you set flow rate in milliliters per minute. Most of the machines now have what's called a peristaltic pump, where you have little rollers which pinch off small amounts of fluid as it turns, pulls it through the eye, and then into a disposal bag. Foot pedal position 3, your valve to the bottle's open, so you have inflow, you have aspiration, the pump is running, and position 3, going down a little further in the foot pedal, you'll hear a buzz when you hear phaco power starting. You pretty much always want to use what's called linear control, which means that you press down a little bit into phaco, you get a little power. The more you push down, the more power you get up to your preset maximum. So I always set it to linear. You want to use enough power to cut the material. You don't want to push the lens material away. So if it's going pushing away, you have to increase the power. You don't want to stay in phaco for a long time, though, because it heats up pretty quickly. I primarily use torsional power with very hard nuclei. It often helps to use some longitudinal along with it if it's clogging or if it isn't cutting when you have it in maximum power. Vacuum level depends on how tightly tissue is held when the tip is occluded. You don't get any vacuum build unless the tip is occluded. And vacuum increases proportionally to the aspiration rate. This is called rise time, that how fast the vacuum rises when you're in position 2. This is an illustration in the top one. If you set if you're setting at 20 milliliters per minute, it may take 4 minutes to get to your 4 seconds to get to your maximum. If you double the speed to 40 milliliters per minute, you should get to rise time to vacuum it in half the time, in 2 seconds. You want to set it fast enough that material moves, but not so fast that it's jerky and you get things that you don't want, like the iris or the capsule. You have different vacuum settings and aspiration rates for different parts of the procedure. If you're doing a grooving procedure, you usually don't need but a little bit of vacuum, 30 to 50 millimeters. But you have to increase it to 200 to 500, sometimes even a little more for removal of lens material to hold it on the tip and aspirate it. Typically for irrigation aspiration, you have a smaller opening. You go at 600 millimeters of mercury typically for IA. Something you have to be aware of is surge, where if you're down to the last pieces, you're occluded and you have max vacuum. You have to be very careful because it can suddenly get pulled in and the vacuum goes from very high to nothing, and you can get collapse of the chamber and tear a capsule pretty easily. So the last bit, you want to be very slow and ginger about using a little bit of phacoid power at a time. Some newer machines have what is called active fluidics. This, instead of just depending on bottle height for flow in, it actively senses and adjusts the intraocular pressure. This helps to stabilize the anterior chamber and the capsule. It's a major improvement in safety because you get a much quieter eye and less likelihood of aspirating the posterior capsule inadvertently. This demonstrates that the gray line is what typically happens with a gravity feed system because there's some lag. The reddish line shows that it's evened out a lot with active fluidics because it senses the pressure in the eye multiple times a second and adjusts it. Aspiration rate sets how fast fluid is pulled through the eye. And this again depends on what phase you're in. You need but about 15 or 20 milliliters per minute for grooving. You can increase to 20 to 50 for quadrants. You want to hold them against the tip more firmly. You want to adjust the rate and you watch how the material is moving. If it's moving too fast, you want to slow down the aspiration rate, or if it's jerky. If it's not moving fast enough, you can gradually increase your aspiration rate until you can get material coming to your tip in a controlled fashion. Bottle height with gravity flow systems determines the flow into the eye. And you want to have it high enough that you have stability of the anterior chamber and posterior capsule. You have to have an even balance between inflow and outflow. If things are going reasonably, normally you'll want to have the bottle height at a maximum. If you have a problem, like you grab iris or capsule, you want to lower the bottle height some and slow down your aspiration rate. With systems with active fluidics, you set the target intraocular pressure, setting it at 55 millimeters is approximately equivalent to 95 centimeters of bottle height, which is usually as high as the average gravity feed system goes. Again, you want to have an aspiration rate fast enough to keep tissue moving to the tip, but not so fast that you have an unstable chamber. If the movements of the material are kind of jerky, or you're getting some movement of the posterior capsule, slow it down in that case. Phaco power. You want to use enough power to cut tissue without pushing it away or moving it. And you only want to cut when you're in contact with tissue. If you stay in contact when you're not, you'll get heating and can get a wound burn. If you're not in contact with lens tissue, go up to position one, inflow or just inflow and aspiration. Normally, if you're in contact with tissue, you will use a little phaco to burr into a piece of nucleus, go back to position two, let the vacuum build. You can hear the sound of the vacuum rise in pitch, then use a little phaco power to emulsify the tissue. Normally, you are most efficient if you use phaco in just a short burst of 1 or 2 seconds and then go back to just aspiration. Once you are in contact with a piece of material and it's on the tip, stay in position 2. Don't go back. Don't take your foot off the pedal. If not, if you do, the piece will fall off and you have to go back down and get it again, which is time consuming and also dangerous as you have material moving around in the capsular bag. Once you have contact with the tissue the vacuum is building, then you can add enough phaco power to emulsify the pieces. Short bursts of a second or two are more efficient than long ones. And you go into phaco, go back to aspiration, and back into phaco. You'll end up using a lot less time, and you'll be less dangerous as far as overheating. The settings are going to vary with what you're doing. Pre-phaco is basically just aspirating the soft material on top of the hard nucleus. And how much there is depends on how hard the nucleus is, typically. Very hard nuclei have little or no cortex and epinucleus. Moderately soft ones, you'll have a good bit. Normally, you just need aspiration, a low flow and low vacuum for aspirating off the soft material on top of the hard nucleus. You want to leave an edge of epinucleus and cortex all around, maybe a millimeter inside the pupil. This gives you sort of a handle to remove the epinucleus and cortex later. A lot of procedures, a lot of techniques, you'll groove the lens and split it. For grooving, you don't need very high flow, you don't need high vacuum, you don't want to occlude the tip, and use just enough linear power to cut and go through. You only want to cut going forward as you're grooving. When you start back to get another shot at it, go back to position 2. That pulls out what you've emulsified, helps cool the tip. And you don't want to occlude the tip while you're grooving. Sometimes you can have a very hard nucleus and you have trouble grooving it, or you can increase your power. If you're in torsional, usually set it at 100%. If it still isn't cutting very well, add some longitudinal and it will cut most nuclei. You can place your second instrument ahead of where you're grooving to help stabilize the lens sometimes, or even over at the equator to hold it to keep from pushing it away. Most procedures, you start dividing the lens in pieces. And while you're learning a simple procedure or a simple technique, is to make a deep central groove, split the nucleus into 2 halves. If it doesn't split, you're not deep enough. You want to go down until you have an even red reflex all the way across, then you use your tip and your second instrument to split it. Once you get it split into 2 halves, you're more than halfway home. If you don't get a good split into 2 halves, you're going to end up with a plate that's going to be hard to manage later. So that first split is very important. A common technique is called divide and conquer. You get your first division, rotate the lens 90 degrees, groove and divide it, and then rotate it on around so that you have an X groove and you have 4 pieces of the nucleus. Then it's relatively easy to emulsify the pieces safely. You stay well away from the posterior capsule and you don't have a whole lot of manipulation. And this shows a typical divide and conquer procedure. Okay, this is the pre-phaco where I'm basically just aspirating the soft nucleus and cortex on top of the hard nucleus. And then I'll start a groove. And watch what the bottom of the groove looks like. If there's any gray material still there, you're not deep enough. You have to go down until you get an even red reflex. Then use the two instruments in the groove to split, rotate 90 degrees, make your second groove. You can see the gray material there. Remember, the lens is a lot thicker in the middle, so you have to go deeper there than you do peripherally. Split, rotate another 90 degrees. Make your third groove. Split it. You want to split all the way to the middle so you free up the pieces from each other. Then you increase your power, vacuum and aspiration, and emulsify each quadrant. As you get close to the end, put your second instrument deep to the tip so you don't aspirate in the cortex with surge at the end. Epinucleus, if you have epinucleus, you don't need very much other than aspiration for that and very little phaco power. Cortex removal is done normally with an irrigation aspiration handpiece. Usually the vacuum uses 5 to 600, rate of 50 to 60 milliliters per minute. And it works best if you do the subincisional cortex first while the rest of the cortex is helping hold the bag open. You start subincisionally and then work around. Bimanual IA, where you separate the infusion and the aspiration, can be very handy, particularly if you're having a problem. You can manipulate each irrigation and aspiration separately. You can use a very low vacuum and flow setting if there's debris on the capsule and aspirate and remove remainder of, bits of tissue that are on the posterior capsule. A silicone or plastic tip is a lot safer than a metal tip if you can get one. So phaco steps are pre-phaco, making a groove for most procedures, removing the hard nucleus, then the epinucleus if there's a significant epinucleus, which is thicker than cortex but considerably softer than the hard nucleus in most patients. And then in irrigation aspiration, you remove the cortex, you can polish the capsule, and then you'll use it to remove viscoelastic after you put a lens in. Now you're going to have problems sometimes. Phaco may stop cutting, the anterior chamber depth may be unstable, tip may clog, you may be in IA and you're not getting any aspiration. You may get a capsule tear. You definitely will get capsule tears. And you can get wound burns. If the phaco stops cutting, the first thing you want to worry about is, do you have a capsule tear and is there vitreous clogging it? The phaco will cut lens material, or it'll cut iris or capsule, but it will not cut vitreous. So you want to make sure first that you don't have a problem with vitreous to the tip. Fortunately, most of the time you don't. And you can kind of wiggle the handle a little bit inside and you can see the end of the needle move back and forth a little bit. It's just loose. You have to come out of the eye, tighten or replace the tip. The anterior chamber is unstable. That means you have inadequate inflow relative to outflow. Now, what can cause that? Being too fast for the bottle height? Bottle may be empty, and which is not uncommon early on that you'll use a lot of fluid. Or you may have excessive wound leak around the phaco tip. You won't have that if you use the correct size keratome so that it's snug but not too tight but not too loose. To correct it, figure out what's wrong and then take care of it. If the anterior chamber is suddenly very deep when you go in, a common cause is called iris capsule block, where as you pressurize the eye, there's a block between the iris and the anterior capsule. And to correct that, you just lift the edge of the iris off the capsule with a second instrument, and the chamber should come back to a normal depth over a few seconds. But again, anytime anything is not looking right, look for a capsule tear. If the chamber suddenly gets deep, suddenly gets shallow, look for a capsule tear and be careful. Now, if you have maximum vacuum but no aspiration, normally the tip's going to be clogged. This is going to be more common with very hard nuclei, and you may be able to use a second or two burst and open it. More often than not, you're going to have to come out of the eye and flush the tip. Sometimes it can be really clogged, and you have to use the stylet from a spinal needle to actually push through to get the material out of it. Then make sure it's flushed and that you're able to aspirate freely. You will get capsule tears, unfortunately, and you need to be aware of them. All of a sudden, you'll notice a very clear area, usually with a pretty straight line on one side or the other. Natural thing to do is come out of the eye. Do not do that. Keep your tip in the eye. Stay in position one, inflow. Use viscoelastic to fill the chamber and help block the vitreous. And when it's largely filled, you can take your foot off the foot pedal and take out the tip. And you have to decide what you're going to have to do to finish the case. If there's adequate anterior capsule, usually the best thing to do is go ahead and put in a lens in the sulcus. It acts as a scaffold and helps keep vitreous back and improves the fluidics in the eye considerably. Because usually you will have some cortex at least. If there's lens, still hard lens material, you have to do it a little differently. You have to get everything forward. You can rotate it. You push pretty much straight forward until you get it under the capsule, or under the iris, I'm sorry, over the capsule. And try to make sure the lens is stable. You can press over the haptics, and if the optic moves away and then springs back, that's a good sign of stability. Then you have to worry about getting the rest of the cortex out. I like the bimanual. It's more flexible and you can manipulate it easier. Work over the IOL as much as you can. Stay away from the capsule tear, or you'll get vitreous there too. You can also remove the remaining cortex manually, just with some DSS in a 3cc syringe, and fill the anterior chamber with viscoelastic, aspirate by pulling on the plunger, and it's slower, but it works just fine. This is a 25-gauge angled cannula. It's usually called a Gill's cannula. And I always like to use a miotic when the capsule is broken. Bring the capsule down. You want to make sure that there's no vitreous to the wounds, to any of the wounds. You have to get the vitreous free of either your main wound or side ports, or you'll get chronic inflammation and CME. But sometimes if you do it this way and you're very careful, you won't get loss of vitreous. Close to 50% of the time, once you get a little experience on realizing you have a capsule tear and addressing it this way. Use lots of viscoelastic. And I was lucky this time. Wound burns. If you use too much phaco power, the tip heats up very rapidly if fluid's not moving well through it, and you can get a burn of the corneal stroma with high power very quickly. Viscoelastic may include your tip. If you go into phaco without aspirating a little bit before, sometimes you can get a wound burn very quickly. So irrigate a little bit when you first start. Aspirate. Don't use more power or longer than you need to. Normally, as you're removing the anterior cortex and epinucleus, you'll see what you're aspirating move into the tip, but sometimes it just gets kind of milky like this, hopefully not very often, which means it's not moving into the tip adequately. And if you look over at the wound, you're getting some gray haze near the limbus. I was not aspirating. The aspiration was loose. I had to go take out and tighten the aspiration line, then go back in. And this is the way you should see fluid go out of the eye as you're aspirating it. And this is a quick chop technique. So the rest of the case went fine. But then most of the time when you get a wound burn, the wound will not seal and you have to suture it. And that induces significant astigmatism. So I'm hydrating the stroma and the side port. And in this case, it happened to seal. That's pretty rare. Sometimes you can be lucky. This is another case where I was assisting a resident, and he was not going back into position two as he was coming back toward him. And I was just telling him that, and then I realized that he was getting a wound burn. He came out. He was able to go ahead and get the rest of the cortex and nucleus out and got a lens in. But it did not seal. So he had to put in sutures, which induces several diopters of astigmatism in that direction. And you need to take out the sutures usually after 2 or 3 weeks, but you're still going to have significant astigmatism. The burn shrinks the corneal stroma. Now, if you're not getting any aspiration in IA, max vacuum, but no aspiration, normally you have a clogged tip, which you have to clean off and flush. Sometimes you'll get chips that get stuck in the opening. You can stuff those in with a second instrument. Now, if your vacuum doesn't build, typically you can have a loose tip or a loose aspiration line. You have to practice using both feet, both hands, your eyes, and your ears. You use 1 foot for the phaco pedal, 1 for the microscope, both hands, 1 for the phaco tip, 1 for a second instrument to manipulate. Your eyes, watch how things are moving and that you're where you want to be, depth and side to side. Stay away from the iris. You have to listen for the sounds and the different functions during the procedure. Practice as much as you can in a wet lab. Be aware of what cycle and function you're in. Be sure you're in the correct cycle for what you're trying to do. Listen for the sounds of each function. A click when you open the valve for inflow. Pump running when you're in position to aspiration. Increasing pitch as vacuum builds. And the buzz to know when you're adding phaco. In I-8, listen for the vacuum to begin to build a cold cortex, then tease it out of the fornix. And it works best if you move parallel to the pupil instead of pulling directly toward the center. It puts a lot less stress on the zonules. Practice as much as you can. There are artificial eyes, artificial lens. And it's very much like learning to play the organ. Playing the organ also requires coordinating both hands and both feet, watching what you're doing, and obviously listening to what you're getting. You want to work in the center of the pupil at the level of the iris as much as possible. Because the anterior chamber is deepest there, you're furthest from the cornea and the posterior capsule. You're less risky at making a capsule tear or getting damage to the endothelium from turbulence and vibration. You need to make sure you know how the machine works before you start. You need to know how to set it up. Most of the time, techs are going to set it up. But you know how to need to know how to check the proper function and know how to troubleshoot it. If things are not working right, you're the boss. You're the one who has to figure out what's wrong and what to do to correct it. Make sure your staff knows how to set it up and change the settings, but you're the one who's responsible for knowing what to do if it isn't working right. You need to know where the tractor is. And the staff and you need to know how to set it up and use it because you will need it periodically. Read any manuals, watch videos, and there are all sorts of good videos of different techniques on YouTube. If possible, record your cases. If you have a problem, you can often see what went wrong and hopefully avoid it in the future. They go well, you can scan through to see what you might improve. You'll probably see there's a lot of dead time where nothing's happening. You can often cut down on that. Practice. It is definitely harder than it looks, but it's an elegant and complicated technique, and it has improved cataract surgery so much over the last 50 years. It's made cataract surgery the best refractive procedure that we have. We can usually help people see well without glasses much or all the time with good measurements, good calculations, and good surgery. And that's a lot of fun, folks. Now, some questions. And I'll read them and then you can answer on your computer with 1, 2, 3, or 4. Question 1, depressing the phaco foot pedal position 2 adds 1 phaco power, 2 fluid inflow, 3 aspiration, or 4 vacuum. So make your choice and then we'll see if everybody agrees. Okay, very good. It adds aspiration. That's exactly right. And 3/4 of you got it. That's good. Question 2. If lens material is moving too fast or jerky. What do you need to do to correct that? Do you lower the bottle height, decrease the phaco power, decrease the vacuum, or decrease the aspiration rate? Decrease the aspiration rate. Lowering the bottle would make it worse because you get less inflow. Phaco power wouldn't have any effect on how fast material moves. Decreasing the vacuum would have little or no effect. You have to decrease the aspiration rate if things are moving too fast. Question three. Irrigate in position one or two before adding phaco power. Why is that? One, to avoid a capsule tear, to avoid a wound burn, to avoid a capsular block, or to avoid iris prolapse. You irrigate before adding any phaco power. It does help some to avoid a capsule tear by keeping the chamber deep, but the big problem that you want to irrigate through is to make sure fluid is moving through the eye is to avoid a wound burn. Four, if you get a capsule tear before removing the phaco tip, do you add balanced salt solution, amniotic, viscoelastic, or a cycloplegic? Viscoelastic, 97%. Congratulations, that's very good. Okay, now questions. I had some questions before. I'll go through some of those. First one has to do with technique. It's usually easier to learn one of the grooving techniques, but chopping techniques are very common and really help to cut down on the amount of phaco power you use and usually makes procedures go faster once you're familiar with them. What do you do in glaucoma? Actually, removing a cataract in a patient with glaucoma often helps improve the glaucoma control. How and when to use pulse and burst modes? There are different ideas about it. You can use a fast pulse. Works usually a little better, with softer lenses. Burst often works better with harder lenses. How to maintain good anterior chamber depth. We talked about that. Make sure your inflow balances your outflow. Increase your bottle height if it's moving, you're not getting good chamber depth, decrease your aspiration rate. How do you save optic nerve from pressure changes during phaco? Unless they have very advanced glaucoma, you're not going to have the pressure up that much or for that long. That should be a problem. Okay, in case of brown lenses, you usually have to increase your bottle height as far as you can, increase your vacuum, and increase power. If you are using a machine that has torsional, you usually have to add some longitudinal to it. And it's not uncommon with brown lenses or certainly black ones. You need to know how to open and remove the lens with a manual extra cap. Ask, are there any standard settings for all machines? No, unfortunately. You can use direct chop techniques in white or brown. Do you want to use a technique of direct chop in white or brown cataract? Brown cataracts if you're going to chop, most of the time you can use a vertical chop, but if you're having a problem, you're going to have to convert and remove manually millions. White cataracts, you want to make sure that the anterior chamber has lots of viscoelastic in it, it's firm. Make a very small opening in the central capsule. If you start getting white liquid coming out, aspirate that with your IA and try to rock the lens a little bit to get any from behind the lens. Remove all the liquid cortex that you can. Then you can refill the bag with viscoelastic, and often there's just a small remaining hard white nucleus. Usually at that point, you can make a normal size capsule of Rexus and chop usually with a small nucleus. It works really well. Okay, criteria for selection of a Phaco machine. If you can get one that has both longitudinal and torsional, a lot of machines just have longitudinal. They work perfectly well. The torsional is a little more, you have a few more choices about different types of lenses, and depends on where you are and, you know, how much money you have to spend, what kind of disposables you need. Best thing usually is ask somebody who is doing Phaco what they're using and what they think the advantages or disadvantages are. My experience is really pretty limited as far as types. I currently am using the Alcon Centurion, which does have active fluidics, which is wonderful. I have, on a number of mission trips, I have used an AMO compact, which also works perfectly well. There are lots of other machines available now. Look around and see what you have. Try to figure out what the advantages and disadvantages are for each one. Okay, pseudoexfoliation and dense lenses. Pseudoexfoliation, most of these patients are going to have glaucoma and they're going to have pupils that don't dilate well. So you have to figure out what to do with a small pupil. Usually the most common thing that you can have is iris hooks, and you need to make sure that you have them available. And if the pupil's not dilating really well, go ahead and put them in at the beginning of the case. If the pupil starts coming down after you're in the middle of it, that's a real problem. That's something that can also happen very easily with patients who are on Flomax or other prostate medications. So learning to anticipate pupil problems and making sure you can dilate the pupil well and keep it dilated is very important. Because if the pupil comes down on you, your likelihood of developing a capsule tear and vitreous loss goes up very high. Posterior polar cataract. That's very interesting, where you have a posterior capsular plaque, and usually the lens material is fairly soft. Normally what you'd want to do on those is not hydrodissect. You want to hydrodelineate, and you work on those from the inside out, from the center out. When you get all the harder material from the center, you can viscodissect under the capsule and often move material away from the posterior capsule. Uday Devgan has an excellent video on YouTube about management of posterior polar cataracts, and I'm sure there are others that are excellent too. What phaco mode is best for hard cataracts? Hard cataracts, usually you're going to have to use at least some longitudinal. Burst mode usually works pretty well, and you just have to see if you're going to be able to get through it. If not, you're better off to switch to a manual extra cap. Okay, Lawrence, do we have some other questions?
Yeah, we have about 10 Q&A questions that were asked. If you want to open those up on your end, if you have some time.
Sure. Q&A.
Yep. If you click on that.
Aha.
So if you want to just scroll to the top, those
are an always available interactive resource online. Good question. Cybersight has, you can ask questions and get a consultant to answer them. It's not always available. There's going to be a day or two delay. If you anticipate a problem before, look it up on YouTube or iTube. And most often there are going to be videos that handle the particular problem you have, because we all have similar problems. Although I've been doing this for a long time and I keep coming up with new ones. Okay. Which phaco technique would I recommend for beginners? I have used chop techniques for many years, like them. I think for most people, the simplest way to learn is what I showed, the divide and conquer. Once you're proficient with that, you can use what's called the Koch stop and chop, where you make a deep central groove, divide the nucleus into two pieces, and then rotate and chop off pieces around of each half. Then there are also excellent quick chop techniques. David Chang's book, Phaco Chop, goes into those with great detail, with excellent video. But you need to get comfortable with a simple technique that's reliable for you. Does the Akahoshi splitter help? It certainly can in softer nuclei. It does not work well in harder ones. Type of anesthesia use, there's really pretty small risk to retrobulbar block or paribulbar. I would definitely use block anesthesia until you're very comfortable and you can do cases in less than 30 minutes. Okay, let's see. Let's come back. There we go. Okay, let's go up, I guess. How previous refractive surgery complicates power. It makes it very poorly predictable. And you need to know how much correction they had. There are calculators on the ascrs.org website that are very helpful. If there's a new machine called the Aura, where you can measure the refractive power once you get the cataract out and before you put the lens in, and that is really neat and usually very helpful if you have it, but it's expensive. We have gotten it. I had a post-myopic patient a couple of months ago that my calculation said use a 19. The Aura said use a 21. I used the 21 and it worked. She would have been hyperopic if I had used the 19. Okay, phaco wound, how do you recommend it constructed? I like a three-step wound, starting either slightly at the clear cornea sclera or clear cornea conjunctiva margin, or even just a little bit into the conjunctiva to make a groove, then go forward with a keratome in the wound for ideally the length of your width of your keratome for your machine. The machine I use between a 2.2 and a 2.4. So it's keratome and very small tip, so it's easy to make a square wound, which is by far the strongest. I do not like corneal incisions. They do not heal well. Limbal incisions, you can't open them hardly at a month postoperatively if you have to go back. Corneal wounds, I have opened bluntly at a year after if I had to go back. Okay, you'd see in Africa, yes, you see very dense and hard nuclei. I know that. If they're black or dark brown, I would use a manual extra cap. Small incision, manual extra cap is excellent, especially if you operate temporally. If you operate superiorly, you're going to get pretty variable astigmatism changes. If you operate temporally, you get much less induced astigmatism. And it doesn't take long to learn how to do that, but it's a little tricky at first if you've been used to operating superiorly. Okay. And instead of hydrating the wounds, can you inject air? I don't think that would work, no. You want to make sure that wound is sealed when you end the case. Air bubble is not going to seal it. It's pretty rare, I think, where there would be an indication for an air bubble. Now, we used to use them before we had viscoelastic. Okay, what should be done when the anterior chamber goes deep when doing segment removal? First thing is worry if you have a capsule tear. And if you do, you have to address that by putting in viscoelastic, taking a good look and seeing what you need to do to finish the case. Look for an iridocapsular block, though, a block between the iris and the anterior capsule. Try lifting the iris off of the capsule if that's what it looks like it is. And if it is, it'll come forward. If it doesn't, it's probably a capsule tear. Okay. Talked about setting IOP at 55. That is for a machine with active fluidics. You set the target IOP for if you have active fluidics. If you have a gravity feed, which is what most machines are, you have to vary the height of the bottle. Jaime, to hold the nucleus to do phaco chop. It often you can hold the harder nuclei better if you use linear, burrow in well, then go to position two, use high vacuum, let your vacuum build, and then chop. And usually that works pretty well. Hope to see you at the academy next week. Okay, how do you change from torsional to longitudinal? Those are just settings on the machine. You have separate set. If you have a machine that has both, there'll be one setting for longitudinal power, one for torsional power, and you can use both together. Okay, that's pretty good, folks.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Berman. I think that's a good place to stop. There might be one more question, and then we can stop.
Okay. Do I recommend to use aspiration for the last segment removal? If it will aspirate, yes. And if it won't, you can often use your second instrument to kind of stuff it in the tip. Use a little phaco along, and usually you can get it in. Just don't use a lot of phaco and let the vacuum get really high before you get in that last little bit.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Downing.
You're very welcome. Thank you. That was fun.
Yeah. Have a good day, everyone.